Just shut the f*** up, Danny. Shut the f*** up.
That scream finally got through to him. The begging, threatening, explaining, and pleading would not stop my son from bouncing off the walls. Only the shouting was effective. Only the swearing worked. My six-year-old son looked up at me as the broken pieces of my Nikon P1000 camera lay scattered at his feet, frozen in place. A chill stabbed my gut as I realized that he was afraid of me. The chill sunk deeper when I realized that a small part of me was grateful for his fear. I wiped a tear from my face.
I'm going outside. Watch your brother. Daddy, I...
Take care of your brother, I hissed while pulling on my shoes. I'll be right outside. I slammed the door, because that's what people do when words run out before anger does. I knew that leaving a six-year-old boy in charge of a three-year-old boy is a stupid thing to do. But Arthur Park is a half a block from our apartment, and I needed to remove myself before I lost control entirely. I collapsed on a bench and heaved. The sun was shining, kids were laughing, and I wanted to smack them for being happy. I closed my eyes and faced the sky.
You look like sh**.
I didn't know who was speaking, but it didn't matter. You try raising two out-of-control boys after their mother dies, and get back to me on whether you care about looking like sh**. I felt him sit next to me. I opened my eyes. He wore a gray trench coat despite the heat, looking like he was either getting ready to sell me a stolen wristwatch or expose himself.
Do you love them?
I stared at the man. He was old, at least 80. He didn't wear it well. His ice blue eyes sunk deep into sallow rice paper skin. Of course I love my kids, I shook my head. This wasn't how it was supposed to go. Amanda was the best woman on earth. Not the hottest, not the richest, just the best. I never doubted fatherhood because I never doubted her. I forcibly controlled my breathing. One thing goes wrong, and suddenly there's a lifetime to deal with the consequences. I nodded. I love them, which is why it scares the shit out of me when I have thoughts of... I froze. He waited expectantly. I shook my head again. I've always thought of myself as a good man. I never understood the pieces of shit who... I pulled my hair. For 5 hours this morning, 5 hours, Danny would not stop. He hit his brother, he hit me, he screamed at us both, and he broke a $1,913 camera that was one of the only joys I had left in my life. As pathetic as that sounds, my breath hitched. That's why I can't even own anything made of glass. I finally snapped. I screamed at him, swore, too, and only scaring my son finally got through to him. When it happened, I thought this made sense, I chuckled. And now here I am, the biggest piece of shit on earth, unloading my life story to a stranger in the park since I'm less of a danger to my children when I'm away from them. I looked back up at the sky. Enough about me. What part of your world did you stop believing in today? He pulled a gadget from inside his coat. It looked like a small remote control with just two buttons on it. The man extended his hand to me, making creepy eye contact as he waited for my reaction.
The top one's for Danny. The bottom is for Kevin.
I wanted to puke as the weight of it fell into my hands, my eyes drawn down toward it. How did you know their name? I looked up. He was gone. The slow creep of panic flowed into the far corners of my body as I hurried home. How could I have left my kids alone? Would they be taken away from me if one had gotten hurt? I was sprinting by the time I reached my apartment door and wasted no time in flinging it open to find Danny and Kevin were sitting quietly on the living room floor, picking up the pieces of my broken camera. I shut the door behind me as a witch's brew of emotion flooded through my head. Relief battled with the nagging thought that my children only calmed down when I was gone. I wondered if my boys would be happier with someone else, and the thought nearly tore me apart from the inside.
I'm sorry I broke your camera, Daddy, and I'm going to...
Danny's voice was cut off by Kevin screaming loud enough to peel the paint from my walls. I covered my ears and looked down to see him lying on the floor, kicking his legs into the air. A broken shard of camera plastic lay near his bare foot. I had left a stabbing hazard in my home for my children to walk across. I clenched my fists in frustration while pressing my hands close against my ears, accidentally squeezing the remote control in the process. Sudden silence. I stared at Kevin in confusion. His eyes rolled wildly around while his trembling lips struggled to scream, but he couldn't make a sound. His lips just looked slightly bluish. That's when I realized that his chest wasn't moving.
Kevin!
I dove to the ground, trying to pull the ancient CPR training from the depths of a reeling mind. It's hard to think straight when your world will end if you can't think straight. I lifted my son's paralyzed body, and then he screamed. He gasped desperately for deprived air, and the noise that attacked my eardrums might have been the most wonderful I've ever heard. I hugged him tight and slipped the remote into my pocket for safekeeping. Both Kevin and Danny became quiet for 15 uninterrupted minutes afterwards. I used the sudden reprieve to race through some financial paperwork, since I didn't know when my next opportunity would be. That's how I found the $1,000. I assumed that it had to be a mistake until I read the memo that appears next to every transaction on the website. Payment for one press of the button. It didn't make sense, but nothing that happened in the past hour seemed real. How did he know that I'd pressed the button? Moreover, how the actual f*** did a remote control cut off a person's air supply for 20 seconds? And why would anyone pay me to choke my son? When I first held Danny in my hands, it was the realest, surreal moment of my life. Amanda and I had created a tiny human that was completely dependent on us for every aspect of his existence. In one short moment, he had completely taken my breath away. I didn't know how it was possible, but I accepted it just the same. I held it together through the tantrum that Danny threw after hearing that it was bedtime. But after he finally passed out, I collapsed on my own bed and cried. I grabbed a picture of me and Amanda that I keep on my nightstand. It's face down most of the time because it hurts too much to see her smile. But I hug it in my weakest moments. "I'm sorry, babe," I whispered. "I want to be the best dad possible. But most days I have to settle for least awful." I slipped the remote control into the nightstand's drawer and tried fruitlessly to get some sleep. Breakfast was blissfully quiet. Danny helped Kevin to pour a second bowl of Cheerios. They said, "Thank you," and "You're welcome." I loved them more than anything on earth. Kevin reached to hug Danny and bumped his older brother's Nintendo Switch onto the ground. It cracked. Danny screamed. Then he leapt to his feet to get better leverage and punched Kevin in the arm. Kevin shrieked loud enough to send physical pain bouncing between my ears. Our entire morning collapsed in 4 seconds. I had to pry Danny away from his brother and carry him to his room, kicking and screaming. But as soon as I released him, he sprinted back to the kitchen. I chased after him to see Danny pick up his destroyed Switch and sob. That was the first time I saw Kevin punch anyone. He slugged Danny in the shoulder, clearly still angry about being hit. He'd learned from his brother. I froze, simply because I was completely unable to conceptualize my next move. My world was filled with noise and nothing else. Then Danny tackled Kevin. I felt like the worst father on earth. There simply wasn't any possible way to express my anger sufficiently, but I somehow had to swallow it all and police their fight. On top of everything, I had to teach them a lesson powerful enough to stop this from happening again. My finger slipped into the pocket of my bathrobe. I don't remember deciding to push the buttons, but I clearly did so with enough intent to hit both simultaneously. Danny and Kevin let go of each other and grabbed their throats as heavenly silence descended upon the kitchen. I waited. Then I dove to the ground and held them both close, rocking back and forth as they gasped for air that wouldn't come. Kevin's face was screwed up in an inconsolable sob. Danny just looked at me in total confusion, wanting so badly to ask why this was happening to him. It felt like things were taking too long. I panicked. Then both boys gasped at the same time, taking in huge breaths of air before hugging me tight as I cradled my sons on the kitchen floor. They forgot about the fight. And that very morning, their college fund was $2,000 richer. Life is a series of hard choices in which the beneficiaries never understand what sacrifices were made for their greater good. I didn't use it excessively, but whenever I got too lax with the remote control, they would start hitting each other once more. I was sleeping soundly again. I barely noticed when Kevin walked into my room that night. "Back to bed," I mumbled. "Read Dragons Love Tacos?" he asked. "No, Kev. Bed. Now." I forced myself up and carried him to his room, tucking him in while half asleep. I locked my bedroom door behind me, which I rarely do, but I didn't want him wandering into my room all night. It was a good call on my part, because the next thing I remembered was waking up to a sunbeam crawling across my face. I stood, stretched, wiped my eyes, and headed toward the kitchen. The living room was a horrific mess. Every couch cushion was shredded. Every soft item had been pulled apart in ransacking that must have taken hours. I marveled at the fact that I didn't hear this taking place, but realized that it made sense, given that I didn't own anything glass or breakable. Had someone tried to enter my room? My blood chilled as I turned around to see deep scratches dug into my bedroom door. I raced toward the boys' room. That's where I saw the vomit. Someone had emptied a day's worth of food. Gelatinous, biley blobs coated the floor and walls. Puddles of puke were connected by long, phlegmy strands of foul-smelling human spit. Farther down the hall, the vomit turned to blood. The victim had apparently run out of food before the puking was done. I sprinted, bare feet splashing in the disgusting fluids as I hurled into the boys' room. I opened the door and my world ended. Danny was dead. No amount of CPR would save a child with lips that blue. The room felt like it was swirling, like a toilet spinning into oblivion, like everything needed to be washed away. My legs were paralyzed, but my head could move just enough to take in the scene. Danny was coated in puke and blood, both of which were drying on his lips. Oh, God, had all the blood been his? I jerked my head looking for Kevin, and then everything made perfect, awful sense. Kevin held the remote in his hand. He must have grabbed it after coming into my room the night before, just before I locked the bedroom door to keep my children outside. Neither one of them would have understood that Kevin's tiny finger on the remote was causing Danny to lose air. He must have been in so much pain when he clawed the deep scratches into my door, unable to comprehend why I'd locked him out. He would have tried so hard to scream. Tearing apart the living room had been the only way to express his anguish as he slowly, slowly died. I don't know how many times Kevin pushed the button to make him vomit blood, but I had an extra $600,000 in my bank account that day. There's never a good reason for a 3:30 a.m. phone call. I was half asleep and half panicked while I fumbled around the nightstand in search of my phone. Hand shaking, I looked at the screen. No name, just a phone number ending in 1913. An unknown person was calling my phone at 3:30 a.m. No, I breathed as I answered. Jacob Adamson? No. I mean, yes, but no. Don't tell me. I'm calling from the Los Angeles Police Department. No. I was hyperventilating. I knew I didn't have the strength to hear what he was leading toward, but I was powerless to hang up the phone. I'm afraid I have some bad news about an accident. No! I shouted. No, you don't tell me that. Just don't say anything. Just stop talking. My heart thudded in my chest. Udi Adamson is your son?
Udi's my boy,
I whispered.
Please take this back, please.
His car lost control on PCH.
No, 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 no! You take it back, you take it all back!
I'm so sorry, Mr. Adamson. Udi died at the scene.
Stop,
I whispered. Movies cut scenes immediately after bad news has been dropped, because the ensuing agony would be too much to watch. 5 minutes of thinking about my dead son was a mental marathon. I fell to the floor, gasping, as I struggled to pull my socks on, only to give up and sob. I needed a break from the moment, just 10 seconds where I could forget about my dead son, just enough to catch my breath. But the pain was unrelenting. I knew that my mind couldn't endure it without cracking. I needed a break. I needed to breathe. But it didn't stop. The biggest trees pop and crack before they fall. I felt that happen inside my head. The cables that had once bound a stable world together snapped apart, turning and turning in the widening gyre. Everything spun out into nothing. What did I have left to look forward to? Life tells us that our children are the greatest accomplishment we can ever have. And now my boy was cooling to room temperature in a meat sack.
You don't need to look at the body, the coroner said.
The lights droned overhead in the sterile white room. The coroner glowed unnaturally.
I have to see him,
I breathed. I think you will regret this choice, he countered. I went in anyway to look at what was left of my son. I regret that choice, I said on my way out. A few days later, I found myself wandering the streets of my town. I stumbled into an empty parking lot and contemplated life. A few moments later, I noticed a strange-looking man appear. He continued to walk closer in my direction. What the f*** do you want? I asked. The man stood next to me.
What makes you think I want something from you?
I'm standing by myself in a barren parking lot, and you found some reason to do the same. People never behave oddly for the benefit of others. He smiled, and I finally looked at him. His trench coat was such a dark brown that I couldn't tell if it was dirty or clean. He was old, pushing 90, and looking like he'd been through hell. His sky blue eyes stood out against skin that hung like rotting peach flesh.
Did your son love you?
My head spun as my stomach flipped. Speaking with such a dry mouth took several attempts. If I still believed the world had any value in it, I would have punched your f***ing face in for asking that. He laughed without any hesitation. Then he touched my shoulder, and I wasn't in the parking lot anymore. In fact, I wasn't anywhere. I didn't recognize the disheveled living room, where a haggard-looking man was shouting at two children, clearly unaware of my phantom presence.
Danny, don't f***ing touch Kevin!
Then there was darkness. A man and a woman appeared next, but I still had no body. She was crying as he watched her in disgust. It doesn't have to be this way, Jasmine. If you're strong enough to put down that godforsaken bottle and apologize, we can move forward. The ball's in your court. She sobbed harder as he turned around and left. Then I was me again, just another person moving as fast as possible toward death.
Hell is real, and it's on Earth.
the sallow man explained.
It's a curse that can only be granted by other people.
The word should have chilled me, but I felt nothing. If what you're saying is true, then we're all the devil, and we're all damned. I turned away from him. He rested a hand on my shoulder.
You're right.
So let me get this straight, I pressed. You think you can bring Yudi back?
There is no think,
the sallow man answered.
Just a choice.
But I have to send two people to hell? I continued.
To Earth. Yes, you understand me.
I didn't like his smile.
I gave you two visions that should not have been physically possible to witness. But you still doubt that the supernatural is natural. You are not among those who have not seen and yet have believed.
I turned away. Then Yudi appeared before me, naked, trembling, and deeply afraid.
He's real, Jacob. All people who ever lived are real. But you can only bring him back by choosing to send two others into hell. Their lives will become excruciatingly painful. Yet they won't be able to let go and move on. Would you make two strangers indefinitely suffer the pain that you find unendurable?
I stared at Yudi. He seemed afraid of me.
Yes,
I whispered.
Let them suffer.
I had no recollection of going home. We were simply standing in the living room, Yudi fully clothed, still staring at me in abject terror. I hugged him. It was like hugging an empty box. I pulled back and saw that he was crying.
I brought you back from the accident,
I whispered. My son looked up at me with bloodshot eyes. It wasn't an accident. It was on purpose, he responded. No, I gurgled. You had every reason to live. He punched the living room window in an explosion of glass and blood. You had every reason for me to live. Everything you ever said to me was designed to tear me down. His eyes and fist dripped freely.
I only ever wanted what was best for you, I stammered.
You only wanted what was best for you, he shot back. I shook my head slowly.
No, it was... If I was ever harsh, it was only to bring out the best in you.
He laughed, and the sound chilled my spine. You could never bring out the best in me, Dad, because it was impossible to succeed by your standards. I looked at myself through your eyes, and I hated the person I saw. I sank to the floor.
Yudi.
I wanted to cry, but that part of my soul didn't work.
Yudi, being without you was... Hell is a real place, because that's where you left me.
He stared back with bloodshot eyes. You'll have a lifetime to get used to it. He turned for the door. Don't follow me. Please stay where I put you.
Hell is real,
I said as the sallow man appeared next to me on the sidewalk. He smiled.
This pain is worse than the first time I lost my son. I'm empty of everything.
He didn't say a word.
And the two others?
I asked.
The man and woman I saw. They're going through hell too?
The sallow man clenched his fist.
People bring hell, but they also bring redemption. Hell is a billion separate places designed to make people suffer alone.
I nodded.
I want to die, but the infinitesimal hope of Yudi returning keeps me alive in the most agonizing way.
We stood in silence.
I'd slit your throat, but that would just make things worse, wouldn't it?
He expelled three heavy coughs. But Yudi, I asked, my voice low and careful. He lives? The sallow man eyed me close and nodded once. I let out a long, tense breath.
Then it is enough.
So, I pontificated, my finger waving hazardously as I swayed on the bar stool. Andy finally broke up with me after weeks of my self-sabotage because I not so subconsciously looked down on anyone willing to date me. Today's fight with my mom probably ended our relationship for good, and the cherry on top is that tomorrow's interview for the regional supervisor position is over before it starts because I'm up against the chief financial officer's niece. What do you say about that? She sighed and crossed her arms. I'll say that I'm sorry because this bar closed half an hour ago. I slipped off the bar stool without a word and walked in a semi-straight line toward the exit. I always feel slightly underwater when I'm drunk, because the world gets wavy, and no one can say anything to hurt me. And, of course, because enough of it will kill me. I chuckled and pushed my way through the door, stepping into darkness. I mumbled, as the latch clicked shut behind me. I'd gone into the alley instead of the street, leaving me to wander in complete darkness until I picked my way out. I looked to the wavy light ahead, balancing delicately as I moved toward it. There must have been an echo, because every one of my steps was immediately followed by another. No, not an echo. Someone was following me. I expected a jolt of adrenaline, but none came. I was okay with being followed. I realized that I didn't want to live or die. The knowledge arrived with a distant sense of surprise, curious but far away. Step, step, step. It was getting closer. I wondered if it would catch me before I found the light. Yes, he would. But I kept walking toward the street lamp ahead. It was beaming just beyond my grasp. As I reached, I felt a full body chill as his arms touched me. Together we walked out of the darkness.
You look lost.
His words were colder than his touch. I pulled my arm away like it had been burned, then turned around to face the man. He wore a gray trench coat that appeared nearly black at the edge of our dark alley. It suited him. He definitely looked the part of an alley pervert.
Do you love your life?
I stared at the ominous-looking man. He was ancient, probably in his 80s, and he wore the years hard. His cobalt blue eyes sunk deep into translucent skin that turned opaque only in the bags beneath his lids. I studied his face. I love the life I wish I had. He pulled a small, black box from inside his coat and extended a gnarled, knobby hand.
To the one who wants to be the best person for the task before them.
It went against every warning that had been drilled into my head since childhood, but I took a gift from the stranger. I looked down as I opened it to find a single black ring inside.
Good luck at your interview tomorrow, Jasmine,
he whispered, in a voice that was so much more chilling because it was an attempt at sounding sweet. How did you know my name? And when I looked up, he was gone. Natalie Bedford walked into the interview looking immaculate from the top of her $500 haircut to the tips of her Jimmy Choos. I was proud of how genuine my smile looked. I had a lot of practice at faking it. We both looked across the desk at Erin. She smiled at me, then smiled wider at Natalie. You've both impressed us over a series of very enlightening discussions. Jasmine, you've continued to succeed in a variety of tasks here at Letchford Eons over the past 7 years. Natalie, in 6 short months, you've proven to be a strong candidate for a supervisory position. It's crucial to see how you interact with people in unexpected situations. So, we've called in our 2 finalists to see how you think on your feet. Her plastic grin grew wider. Natalie, what would you say if 2 of your subordinate task managers refused to work together? I twirled the ring on my finger, sliding it across the sweat I kept hidden in my palm. While it didn't have any real emotional significance, I'd decided to wear it after realizing that it was the first gift I'd received in 2 years. Well, I'd say this is why you should only hire white people. She slapped both hands over her mouth as her eyes bulged. Erin and I stared at her in silence. But it was too late. The supervisor position came with a lot more benefits than simply doubling my salary. I finally had authority over the people whose slack I'd been picking up for 7 years. And my new office was half the size of my entire apartment. Natalie had ordered several pieces of furniture from Wayfair before her interview, and they fit my office perfectly. Since they'd been purchased on the company dime, I was allowed to keep them. She seemed as shocked as I had been at her answer, but no matter how much she begged, pleaded, and swore she didn't know why those words came out of her mouth, it was too late. HR had been notified, and there was no way that she'd ever get a supervisory position with that on her record. The interview had immediately ended with my promotion by default. With Natalie out of the picture, there was no denying that I was the best person for the task. I should have realized that my $500 haircut and Jimmy Choo's would make me a target.
You can spare a few bucks,
the scraggly man muttered as I walked by. I almost hadn't noticed him curled up on the fringes of the streetlight's glow, but he was impossible to ignore up close. Every tooth was black and rotting. His hair hung in tangled, greasy strands that clearly hadn't been washed in days. His long, broken fingernails were dirty and yellow, and track marks blemished both arms and his neck. I could smell his smile. Sorry, I can't right now. It wasn't a question. Pressed, stepping forward. Click. He'd drawn the switchblade before I even realized that he was moving his hand. I looked frantically around the dark street to realize that we were completely alone. He'd planned this attack carefully. I stepped back, trembling as he moved forward. I squeezed my purse with my left hand and covering the ring with my right thumb, fruitlessly hoping to protect them both. Only one of us is leaving with your cash, he gurgled, raising the knife higher.
And I don't think you're up to the task.
What? I gasped. He reached for the purse as I raised a hand to protect myself, and we both stumbled, his arms pinwheeling while I spun around and he lost his balance. He hit the ground with the sickening crunch thud of a watermelon colliding with human teeth. He groaned and rolled over. The knife stuck out of his chest. Its blade lodged between his ribs. Frothy blood churned a continual stream of air bubbles from the open wound. I was watching a human lung deflate. His spinning eyes finally found me. The man's cracked lips tried to form words that couldn't escape from a dying lung. He wanted me to help him. I reached in my purse for the phone. Then I stopped. We were completely alone. I hesitated. Then I ran. I tapped my finger against the steering wheel as I hugged the curves. This, technically, was the long way to work. But that was a deliberate choice. Route 1913 added 20 miles to my trip by making a rural loop around the city. But it cut out all traffic, and the BMW M3 was a hell of a lot of fun on winding country roads. I spun the ring on my finger as I smiled, lifting my hand as I reminisced, finally telling Roger in accounting that he needed to spend more than 10% of the day on his actual job. The ring bounced off. A jolt of fear shot through me as I instinctively dove after it, slapping the floor in panic. I knew I shouldn't take my eyes off the road, but I only took half a second to grab it before I was looking out the windshield again. The car was still going straight. I relaxed. Then I realized I had changed lanes and was about to drive into oncoming traffic. I overcorrected just as a bridge came into view, and there was no doubt that I was going to crash. The car had too much power before the turn, and all I could do was brace myself. It spun so violently as it crunched and crunched and crunched and crunched, and I was reminded just how tiny and fragile my body was against a world that truly didn't care if I died. I wasn't upside down or right side up when the spinning stopped, because it's impossible to know which way gravity works when everything you feel is pushing back. All the world was smashed, and I couldn't move in this claustrophobic prison that kept me mangled on all sides. I didn't have enough energy to cry. It took several seconds to find my right arm. It was still attached, but felt wrong, like my elbow had forgotten which way to bend, and my shoulder was a long way from where it should be. I was glad the arm was pinned out of sight beneath my body, because I was terrified of what it looked like. I wanted to pass out, but that release eluded me. Hazy, semi-consciousness untethered me from understanding, with enriched pain serving as the lone cord between stark reality and fever dreams. Mom and Andy and 1,000 other images stood large and wrapped me in giant hands, crushing my chest so that I couldn't inhale. I awoke to the taste of copper in my mouth and the feeling of drowning. The car's metal frame had closed so tightly around me that I couldn't take a full breath. I hadn't prayed in years and had never done so with a full heart, but I called out to God and Satan in my mind, promising to love whichever one ended my pain first.
We found something,
came a voice from above. It sounded distant, like it was filtering through a swimming pool that wanted to drown me slowly. But they came closer, and I made the stupid choice of letting myself hope.
We're going to set you free. Just hang on for me, okay?
I turned my head slightly, stopping when shards of glass pressed into my soft cheeks. I didn't even try to cry. The glass was too sharp and too close to my face for anything but complete stillness. Daylight flooded in as they pulled debris away. A hand came through the light. It touched my shoulder, and I screamed with agony. The arm bounced back in shock as I heard the unmistakable sound of tearing flesh, just like a raw chicken breast was being pulled apart by its fibers.
Holy sh! Mitch, your arm!
The second voice was close, very close and filled with panic. It must have been the paramedic's partner, and he sounded like a man about to lose control.
There's so much broken glass. I told you to stay back. Mitch, you're bleeding. It's everywhere.
Okay, Jim, listen to me. I've severed my brachial artery.
Listen, we don't have much time. How are you so calm? Look at your f***ing arm. You're going to die.
Mitch, stay quiet and listen. This is what being a paramedic is all about. We stay calm. This is a rough situation for your third day on the job, but I need you to stabilize my arm before I lose consciousness.
My heart beat faster with each word.
I wanted to cover my ears, but my arms were still pinned.
Okay, Mitch. I'm calm.
The second voice responded in a slightly less terrified tone.
Okay. Holy sh**, is that a pool of gasoline? Mitch, the entire undercarriage is sparking, and the smell is getting worse.
I nearly puked when the odor hit me. Somewhere nearby, a lot of gas was leaking.
Jim,
Mitch groaned in an extremely tired voice.
We're very short on time.
I'm about to...
Look, if you want to be the best paramedic possible, then prove it through whatever task fate hands you.
Oh, sh**.
I rubbed the ring. I'd slipped it back on my finger just before the accident, and it sat snugly at the base of my finger. I tried to slide it off. It didn't budge. My arm was too pinned, too mangled for even such a simple task. I wanted to sob, but the car kept my lungs from expanding wide enough.
The sparks hit gasoline! Mitch, can you hear me?
In the ensuing moment of silence, I heard the first flicker of flame.
Oh, sh**! Mitch, we have to get the f*** out of here!
Mitch remained silent.
I'm sorry.
He sobbed.
I'm so sorry. I should have never been a paramedic. I should have never been here at all.
The receding sound of his footsteps was quickly replaced by the noise of a growing fire. For the first time, I spoke.
I didn't realize it before,
I moaned.
And I'm sorry. Please, somebody hear me. Please.
I cried softly as the glass cut my face.
I want to live.
My leg was suddenly wet. Heat followed. The fire was still small and would nibble at little bits of me while it prepared for the main course. I sobbed openly now, not caring that my cheeks were getting cut to ribbons as the heat began to roast my leg meat right on the bone.
Thanks for watching. Be sure to subscribe and smash that like button to get notified every time I upload a new video. You can also check out some more of my animated horror stories right here.